All right, I know that I'm just the entree and the meal is coming up later, so I'm going to try to go as quickly and as entertainingly as possible. But thanks, Mike. Thanks, Dean Pike. Liz Mueller, thanks. The investors that are spending some time with us tonight, thanks for that, and the entrepreneurs. I'm really honored that I could say a few things and share my experience and my perspective on Nixon before this fun night. But before I get going, I'm going to use this slide a little later, and I know I'm a little bit older than some folks out there, and so it's a social reference, and I want to make sure that people know who this is, otherwise my point will not be made. Everybody know who these guys are? Are the younger, all right? So the guy on the right, Richie Cunningham, and the guy on the left is the Fonz. It's from a show called Happy Days that was popular, I don't know when, but I watched it as a kid. And the Fonz, you know, Richie did everything right, and the Fonz was this greaser, kind of edgy guy, and he was the cool guy, though. He was super cool. He could just bang the jukebox, and a song would play. That's how cool he was. So we're gonna see him a little bit later. But and again, before we get started, I want to show you a little bit of video of what Nixon, what's inspiring about working at Nixon. Some of the people that we work with. We have the lights.
In the dead of night, love.
pretty thanks. So a pretty insane group of people that have a very unique point of view on the way that they look at the world and what they do. And we partner with them to figure out what we should build. When we just started out, one of the pro snowboarders said, hey, look, you know what you need? In any watch, it needs to look cool, tell time, and not break. That's it. If you can do that, you're in business. And so we use these guys to make sure they look cool. And then we make sure they don't break and tell time. So first, a disclaimer. I'm not going to tell you anything original tonight, right? I'm not going to tell you any of my original ideas. And even that is not an original idea. Mark Twain said there's no such thing as a new idea. It's just over and over and over. And what I want to talk about is my experience with Nixon is really just a combination of what a lot of really smart people told me. And that provides another unique perspective. And so the idea, sometimes as entrepreneurs, you're like, oh man, I got to have this mind-blowing newness. But sometimes you really don't. A combination of pedestrian experiences can give you that mind-blowing perspective. So a lot of smart people told me a lot of things. One of them, we'll start with our own Mike Lawless. He said, speak for 30 minutes, give 10, 15 minutes for questions, and hit four main takeaways. So that's what I'm going to do. All right? So the four things I'm going to talk about is, the first one is, should I or shouldn't I? You're either coming out of school or in a job. Should you start a business or should you not? So I want to talk about that. The second thing is, say you say, yeah, I'm going to. The second thing I want to talk about is, well, where's the money going to come from? Where am I going to raise money and how am I going to do that? The third one is, now you're off and growing. And I've got some observations about the growth spurt and the growth experience I had with Nixon. And the fourth thing is, you know, looking back, if I had known a couple things when I started, what would those things are? So you can save all that time. So the should I or shouldn't I? I am not a risk taker. I hate risk. I grew up in potentially the most stable household in America. Right? I was going to go work for GE, work for 50 years, and retire. That's what I was going to do. I got a job. I studied engineering because I was guaranteed a job. Right? I was stable. Entrepreneurs in my mindset back then were the guys that were in the hot air balloon going around the world, you know, trying crazy stuff. That just wasn't me. But then I went to work for a guy named Jake Burton at Burton Snowboards. And that guy had so much fun every day, making stuff up as he went. It really kind of blew my mind that you could have a very, very, very challenging job in which you really didn't know what was going to happen next and somehow weave in a bunch of fun. And I was like, that's what I want to do. But as an engineer, I knew F equals MA and what a side cut looked like on a snowboard, but I knew nothing about running a business. And so I wanted to go back and get an MBA. And when I went back to school, the idea of entrepreneurship for me was demystified by this simple equation. You know, on one side, there's opportunity. On the other one, there's resource. And the entrepreneur, I think if there's a person who studies the history of words, they'll tell you that all entrepreneurs do is go from one side to the other and back and forth. The opportunity side, and you learn a structured way of thinking. Is it a good opportunity, a bad opportunity? What's the competitive set look like? What's the dynamic in the market? What are the incumbents most likely to do if you enter the market? So you're studying this opportunity. Is it big? Is it small? Fast growing, shrinking? What's it like? And resource is typically something you don't have. So an entrepreneur isn't just saying, well, that's a great idea, but now where am I gonna satisfy that? And so bringing those two things together demystified it for me. Because typically you want to do that in the lowest risk way possible, right? Just because you're an entrepreneur doesn't mean you love risk. And this resonated with me as a non-risk taker, saying, this is super simple. Now all I need is an opportunity. But I want to show you an image to encapsulate what this opportunity and resource to me meant. So when my daughters were 2 and 4, and making chocolate chip cookies with mom, the 4-year-old got the spatula and all the good frosting, but the 2-year-old had a unique perspective on an opportunity. 2-year-old didn't have any resources, except maybe what she was born with. And so she took her shot and got a big lump of chocolate off my 4-year-old's shoulder. The idea is, and that's a low risk attitude right there. She could have got fought with the spatula and give me that spatula. She's like, no, this is my opportunity. I'm going to go get that one. So there she is. That resonated with me, right? And this was exciting. So now where's the opportunity? You know, I wish I could start a business. Oh man, when am I going to get an idea? And as luck would have it, I get a phone call from a former colleague that I knew through the snowboard industry. And he said, you know, and this is his pitch, right? We're in a pitch contest. This was his pitch to me. Watches. That was it, one word, watches. Right? Next slide, you know, what else you got? But he saw an opportunity. He went, he had his first job out of school, he was making some money, he wanted to buy a nice watch. He went to a place he was comfortable shopping at in a local surf shop, found nothing but like cheap plastic digital stuff. So he's like, well, I want a real watch. So he went to a nice watch store. He's like, well, these are all kind of old man watches. It's like, why can't I get a real product that respects me as a customer in a place that I like to shop in the action sports world? And so he needed a resource. He needed a product guy, because he was a brand guy. He needed a product guy and a business guy. And I was a product guy in business school. So he contacted me to get his resource. And then I said that was a dumb idea. It was too small. It's a niche on a niche on a niche. I'm like, I don't see how this is ever going to work. Here's a list of things why this thing won't work. And he kept at it. And he's like, well, we could do this. We could do that. As we kept talking, that list got smaller and smaller and smaller. I'm glad that there was a ton of things on that list. But I wouldn't have done it if there was tons. So we just thought about how we can eliminate risk at every step until we got to a point where we're convinced. And you hear a lot in the entrepreneurship world, in the regular working world, about the need for passion. Like, you need to be passion driven. And I'm here to tell you that I did not have a passion for watches, right? I did not feel that I met that high bar. And so, but I was convinced. And there's a difference between passion and conviction, right? Passion is something that you're just so engaged on, and you're gonna do no matter what, and you're gonna make it happen. Well, conviction is knowing that it's going to happen. It's the same kind of planned forcefulness that passion doesn't necessarily have. So I think passion is fantastic. If you can get it, go for it. But if you don't sit around and wait till you're passionate. I think a conviction of saying this is gonna happen, and you can plan for it, you can focus it, you can get your energy. You think this guy's passionate about what he's about to do? I doubt it. I think he's focused. I think he's convicted. He's convinced he's gonna break those blocks, but not passionate about it. So I'm all for passion, don't get me wrong, but I don't think that I had it, but I loved my job. So we got convinced, and we back and forth, and we're ready to go. And the next step for me and Chad, my partner, was, or are we the right resource? Are we gonna work together as a team? How is this gonna work? And I was lucky enough to see Steve Jobs speak when I was at Stanford. And he talked about finding San Francisco. Like, if you're in Austin and you wanna go on a road trip, and you say, let's go on a road trip. You can get a bunch of people in the car, and you maybe 20 minutes out of town, and you'd be like, well, where the heck are we going? And if you get that same road trippers in the car, and they said, let's go to the West Coast, you know, you might get as far as maybe Phoenix, and then there could be an LA and San Diego division, right? But if you find San Francisco, and you as a founding team can argue and argue and argue that that's your San Francisco, that you have it convinced, then the arguments can be like, well, should we go north and the south, north and the west, or west and the north? Should we take the plane, the train, the bus? Can we do all those other things? Go ahead and argue. But you will get to San Francisco. So I took that advice to heart, and I locked Chad in a room for 3 days. Like, why do you want to do this? Well, I just think it would be cool, because like nobody's doing it, but why is that? You know? And I asked him the question, why, 5 times in a row? And it got down to, he's like, well, I've always worked in crappy places that I don't want to go to. And I kind of would like to create an environment that people are psyched to go to, that we're doing something that's exciting. So, and he asked me the same 5 questions, and we get down to it, and I'm like, you know what? We should probably, we see San Francisco, now we can argue about how to get there. So let's do it. And so I was almost all set to ready to go to do this, and I had one more phone call to make. And that was to my girlfriend. And this might get a little too personal, but I was like, okay. She was in grad school, I was in grad school. Hey, what are you gonna do after grad school? What are you gonna do? And I'm like, you know what? I think I'm gonna start this company. And right then and there, I think she could have said one or two things. Either, you're crazy. You owe Stanford 80 grand. What are you gonna do? Go out and start a company making watches? Dude, it's 1997, people don't wear watches anymore. Or she could have said, I think that's cool. And Liz Rawson, now Liz Lotz, that's what she said. And I guess the point that I wanted to do this, wanted to bring this up was, it's very hard. I had a hard time with this business. It is all encompassing. It is all engrossing. I was on it, and I loved it. It was great. And if I had to go home, have somebody be like, oh, this is a crazy idea, who knows, and somebody poo-pooing it or not supporting it, it would have been two battles to fight. Instead, there's one. Like, we were all in. This was great. And as you think about whether this path is the right path for you, or if you've already made that decision, I would say that the likelihood, again, the anti-risk part of me was like, wow, I've got somebody in my corner. And they think that this path is cool. And that support I used throughout the next 16 years. So that's it. We're like, okay, should I, shouldn't I? I'm gonna do it. Let's go for it. Where's the money gonna come from? All right, we figured we'd need to raise, well, I needed 50 grand to write a business plan from a seed guy, which I got from a friend of mine in his garage. Hey, what are you gonna do after graduation? Oh, I think about doing this. He's like, that's great, what do you need? I'm like, 50 grand to write a business plan. He's like, okay, cool. Checkbook, here you go. He didn't have 50 grand, I found out later. But he also didn't bug me about equity or anything like that. So he was just, he backed me up. And with that 50 grand, we made a pitch. And because this is a pitch competition, I wanna show you Nixon's pitch. And you know how it worked out. We ended up getting the money, but what do you need to start a watch company, right? Our idea was, well, you need to have three things. You need to have access to opinion leaders to tell you what to make. You need to have access to manufacturing to make it. And you have to have access to a distribution channel to sell it, right? So we need to figure out how to design, make, and sell watches. This industry is 500 years old and there's 400 brands. And the amount of space you're working with is very tiny. So how do you differentiate? Like, why do we need 501? Well, we looked at this and said, hey, look, those guys, all the Swatches and Timexes and Fossils in the world, they know how to make a watch. They've got one out of three things you need. Where we know how to design a watch, we know how to sell a watch, we have access to opinion leaders through the snowboarders that we knew, the surfers that we knew, we have access to the distribution channel through sales reps, and we knew these niche retailers. We have no idea how to build a watch. So that's our pitch. We're gonna start a watch company, we have no idea to make a watch, but we have two out of three and they have one out of three, right? We still have to figure some stuff out. So this is a risky idea. It might not work. But we think that you're betting that we can figure out how to make a watch before all those other guys can figure out what Tony Hawk is gonna think is cool and put into a niche distribution, right? The interesting thing about this pitch for me personally was it was ridiculously liberating. I didn't have to have all the answers. And to sit down in front of a potential investor and say, I have no idea how to build a watch. I've never done it before in my life. But that's your core category, right? That's what you're gonna sell. Yep, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. I think by telling them that I didn't know, the things that I thought that we really knew, that we were convinced about, I know that retailers will sell this. I know that the team riders will do this. I know that this is going to happen and that's going to happen. I think that gave me credibility on those things that I did know. But that was it. That was our pitch. And we went out. Hey, who can I talk to? Who can I talk to? Who do you know? How do I know? Here's a list of a bunch of people that we're going to talk to. And we went out and talked to about 170 people. We figured we'd need 20 people to write $50,000 checks. So a little over an 8-to-1 hit ratio. So that's whatever that is, 150 people saying no. You have to be convinced to get through those 150 no's to get to those 20 yeses. But you learn something in the process and you get even more convinced, at least we did, all along the way. Well, I want to tell you one story about raising money from my perspective, I had networked into this guy who had an office in Sand Hill Road in Palo Alto. Now, Sand Hill Road, have you guys heard about Sand Hill Road? It's like, Sand Hill Road is like where the VCs are. And everybody at Stanford Business School is sort of like, oh, Sand Hill Road, you're gonna get a job, Sand Hill Road, wow, Sand Hill Road. Now, Chad, my business partner, right, he's a surf guy from Westlake Village. I'm like, come on, we're gonna go make the pitch. And we got our seed investor as well, who was a sales guy. And this guy scheduled meetings in 20-minute segments. He's like, all right, you got from 11 to 11:20. I'm like, that's pretty high pressure. So, you know, I had to get Chad already, right? The sales guy can sell, right? I'm not worried about him, but Chad, like, Chad, dude, you know, like, zip your fly. You know, don't wear sunglasses inside. You know, please stay awake. It's only 20 minutes, you know. But please, 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 you know, this is Sand Hill Road. This guy's a big deal. And so we get into the room, and it's a small room. I thought it'd be like this kind of crazy Wolf of Wall Street room, but it's a small room. And he had all these sports trophies all over the place, and the whole one side of his wall was just screens. Like, the whole right side was maybe 6 screens. Numbers all over the place. So there we are, Humpty Dumpty, Louie, sitting there, and he's like, okay, so what are you guys doing? And I'm like, in business school, so I'm like, keyword, keyword, buzzword, buzzword, pitch, pitch, like just boom, 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 boom. I take like 10 minutes and I lay the whole thing out and I'm like, oh, this is gonna be great. He's like, okay, got it. Goes to the next guy, the sales guy, what are you gonna do? He's like, I'm a salesman. He's like, I sell Burton snowboards to 300 accounts on the West Coast. I can place this stuff in, you know, 300 accounts, no problem, great. Goes to Chad. Chad, what do you do? I'm kind of like the Fonz. High risk strategy, right? And the guy finally looks away from his screen, right? I'm talking, he's looking at the screen. The sales guy's talking, looking at the screen. Finally, he looks up and just starts cracking up. Like, okay, I get it. And he wrote a check for 100 grand. It's like, psyched. Yeah. You never know. I mean, that's the other thing. It's I don't know. Yeah, this might happen here in San Diego. It certainly happened to us. I raised about 150 grand in a hot tub one night. You know, my classmates and I are in the hot tub, we're about to graduate. Andy, what are you gonna do? And I'm like, oh, it's gonna be great. I'm gonna do this. And by the end, they're like, I'm in for 50. I'm like, well, I wasn't ready. They're like, no, I'm good. So some of it was easy, but there were 150 people that said no, and that part was tough. But as it worked, you know, we raised about $1 million, 993,000 to be exact, and we went for it. Now we were in the growth mode. And it was heads down, and we're gonna go. And there's 3 things I wanna talk about in the growth, or the observations from my growth. The first one is that here we are, a consumer product company. The first 12 months after landing money, it was B2B. We were just talking, why were other businesses gonna work with us? If you think of a sales rep, we had to convince sales reps to spend their time to introduce us to retailers. Retailer, we had to convince a retailer to take all the wax and the stickers out and put watches in. We had to convince service providers, we had to convince everybody that we were gonna actually be in business in 6 months or 10 months. So it was amazing that there had to be a business reason for all of our partnerships before we even got to play on the B2C world, where a consumer would actually look at our product. That took me by surprise. I had thought that, hey, it's B2C. It's like you put your shingle out and people see your watch and then you're in the business. But it was a lot of convincing other business people up the chain. Now, sometimes people at a consumer product company are like, hey, I got this new pen, I wanna make this pen, but I have no idea how to make this thing. Like, don't worry about that. When you're making something, you're the customer. You go to a factory or a designer and say, I want to make a new pen. They go, great, that's going to cost you this much money. You have that much money? Yeah, I do. Okay, great. There's nothing to convince there, right? Making something is pretty easy, even if you don't know how to make something, like we didn't. But going over to the factories and saying, hi, my name's Andy, I got a backpack full of drawings, I'm going to be a watch company. They're like, great, let's take a meeting. They see customer. Going into a retailer and say, hey, I got these great watches and all these guys like them and look at them, they're pretty cool. They're like, yeah, what's the margin? What's your return policy? I don't know, these sunglasses are doing pretty good, thanks. You know, selling stuff is much harder than making stuff, and being a B2B versus a B to C, it changed my point of view. The second observation I want to make from the growth part was there was this crazy balance that I couldn't connect. You know, here we are, full speed ahead, totally convinced, funded, let's go. Nothing could go wrong now. The optimism, the energy, like Dave Pike said, the sort of we could do anything feeling was everywhere. You know, it was so much fun. But also, and sometimes, you're just convinced that something was gonna go wrong. And I had a real hard time like connecting these two things. You know, this is a quote from Tom Friedman. Greatest change in the world is made by optimists. You know, and that was the feeling. We're like, this is going to be great. All we could see was success. But then in my deepest, darkest moments, I'm kind of like, well, what if this happens? And what if that happens? And what if this happens? Well, those guys could do that, and then we're done. And what if that doesn't show up? And there was always this pessimism. And I couldn't figure out how to balance those two. And then I remember something my buddy from grad school told me, his boss said once. Entrepreneurs are long-term optimists, short-term pessimists. Perfect. I can take that. I can work with that, right? Because I can keep my long-term optimism. This is going to work, but I can still worry about everything every day and every minute. So this balance was something. You know, looking back at the observation there is the balance of humility and boldness. You know, of anxiety and thrill. It was simultaneous, and it like almost diametrically opposed. And so, how do those two things work? You know, which one is it? Should I just like hide my fears and go for my strengths, or should I listen to my fears? And those things were really important. And a final observation from our growth, and this is boring, not completely satisfying, and in fact, extremely important. This is something that every great parent tells their kids, right? Boring. Not satisfying, but important. I was able to go to Keith Van Horn, I think his name is Keith, he was Professor Van Horn, so I don't know his first name, but his book on corporate finance was in the 12th edition back in 1997. I wouldn't be surprised if it's still in circulation, if they still have textbooks now. And I'm like, hey, Professor Van Horn, will you look at my financial model? Can you check out this? Sure, son, no problem, but cash is king. That was all he told me. I got another appointment, kid. Get out of here. But this piece here is boring, not satisfying to know, but really, really important. Spring of 2002, we had so much inventory because fall of 2001, planes went into buildings and people stopped buying stuff. And for an hour or an hour and a half every day, me and my controller looked at our cash flow. And every day, who's going to pay us? Who are we going to pay? Who's going to pay us? Who are we going to pay? We're a $10 million business. We're growing like weeds. Everything's fine. It's like, we have to figure that out. So the observation was, as boring as it is, that is really important. So during the growth, the observation where it's like, hey, a consumer product company could be a business-to-business business. That balance of boldness and timidness is something that I learned to embrace. And somebody in the organization needs to be intimate with the cash flow, or it ain't gonna happen. So looking back, what do I wish I had known when I first started? Starting a company is a dream. You know, it is all-encompassing, like I said before. You need a ton of support. It's as hard as it is rewarding. It will reveal your strengths and your weaknesses. More than anything else will. It is a humbling experience of self-discovery. You know, that's bigger than any job I ever had. And it happens all the time. It is just like birth. A miracle of birth happens the 83rd billionth time. You know, and you know who does this stuff? It's people like you. I was like, oh my gosh, starting a company. Like so intimidated by that idea, but it happens all the time. And if you study it, if you study entrepreneurship, you know, you can make a decision about your career path. If you don't study, you can just think it's wild guys riding around in balloons, right? But if you study it, you can say, here's a normal career path, I get this, and here's an entrepreneurial career path, and now I understand that, and you can make an informed choice. And if you don't choose the entrepreneurial path, Well, guess what? My bet would be that all the things that you learn by studying it will help you in almost any job. So that is something that I wish I had known, that it happens all the time to people that just study it and work hard on it and want it to happen. It isn't for crazy people. So my four takeaways to get done with that is a calculated low-risk endeavor can be a startup, and it can be demystified to a point of something might this resonated with me in terms of the opportunity resource. Something else might resonate with you. Passion is great if you have, but it's not required. I don't think it's required. I think conviction and knowing yourself and being honest about what that is, I think that's required. And if you get passion, fantastic. The third one, boring but true, is it gotta know the cash flows. It's just not sexy, but it is true. And finally, if it happens all the time and it happens to you, then it will do nothing less than really change your life for the better. Thanks. Yeah. We're running a little late, so do we have time for...
Yeah, maybe two quick questions.
Bueller?
Yeah, I have a question. I know that you guys are involved in the snowboard industry, so how did you decide on landing in San Diego?
So back when there were snowboard magazines, 70% of the world's snow, surf, and skateboard manufacturers are in San Diego County or Orange County. Like, this is the Hollywood of that industry. So there was network benefits from being here. Good talent pool and mostly where the media came from. Southern California also has a great brand in and of itself, right? Especially in youth market, we're finding that people like California, they know California. If they've never skateboarded, it's still okay. Great, thanks again. Oh wait, sorry. Maybe I would, I think we're all kind of worrywarts, to be honest. We're creating a brand is a slow process, and so you don't want to mess it up. But every touch point, every time, so we're always kind of trying to push in the same direction. So I think the idea that if you study it hard enough and try to pressure test it, that something that might look risky at the beginning, you feel much more comfortable about doing it. Yeah.